Ooh, wow. All right. Welcome to the show. Sort of actually have some set decorations here. How's everyone? We dedicate the merit of this time here. To the utmost steady determination and discipline for everyone and generations to come, that they will take it to heart, take the path to heart. It doesn't happen unless one actually does it, you know? It's not magic. There's no magic. Steady determination is the magic. So here we are in California. Some rain's coming in again. It's taking its time to get here. It's cold outside. It's you know, waiting for the warm weather to arrive, the warm weather. But what we're doing here is really 99 days of spring, starting February 13th. 99 days of spring, okay, which goes up to... I have a calendar here. It goes up to, I think, like, yeah, May 22nd. It goes up to May 22nd from February 13th, which is the birthday of Longchenpa. That's the day I decided to become an apex yogin, up to March 22nd. Then we take a week off, 6 days off. And then on the 29th of May, in the United States, it's Memorial Day. It's the beginning of summer. And then we do 99 days of summer, which takes us exactly through to Labor Day in September. September 4th. So that's exactly 99 days. 99 days of summer, and we're doing 99 days of spring to lead up to 99 days of summer. The 99 days of summer. So I like to do this to keep the motivation going. So you realize that time is flying by, and you can't fritter it away. You have to, every day, you have to do something significant. Okay, every day. I got the heat pad on here because it's chilly. Round, woo. Hey, whoa, hey, ah, yeah. Do something significant every day. Many things significant every day. So today, for instance, I taped audio to Longchenpa's Song of the Enchanted Wildwoods. The problem is the video kept stalling out, so it's not going to be synced up properly. But at least I went through the whole thing. I made about 20 mistakes, though, so I have to do a better job. But I did it. I tried it, and it did pretty well. So I'll try it again and see if I can iron it out. You know, it's very profound. It's very profound. So that's like pushing through procrastination. I also swung my golf club driver in 3 and 4 wood. At the new high speed swing I have, the new high speed swing, for the first time, and that was pretty amazing. It worked. I said, wow, this is going to work. So I mean, a couple years of working out, and now I'm seeing it's going to work. It's going to work. The swing is fast. It's really fast. So. And there's a correlation. We want spiritual progress to be really fast, right? We want to go a long way. I want to hit the golf ball a long way. But we want to go a long ways towards the peace of God. A long ways, fast. I've got Dion here. Great singer, Dion Amici. Great music. Really, I mean, you can't top it. This is the king of doo-wop with the Belmonts and Wow, the Del Satins later on. He was only at the Belmonts like about a couple years, less than a couple years, then the Del Satins came in. Basically, he went down one day. He sang a song for somebody, a friend, and his friend said, "Wow, that's really good." And his friend was friends with someone else who was actually starting a recording company, and he says, "Go down and audition for it, my friend." And Dion said, "Okay." So he walked in and said, "I'd like, can I audition?" And they said, "Okay, sing us a couple songs." So he sang a couple songs, and they signed him right on the spot. They said, "Wow, you're really good." He was a teenager when he did this, and he didn't have any backup singers that time. So what he did then is that he went back to where he lived and just asked these guys, the best singers in the neighborhood, because the people were singing on doorsteps there in New York, and he said, "Let's practice. Let's could back me up." And so the guys that he picked became the Belmonts, named after Belmont Avenue. And I mean, they're really, really, really good. And so they just started recording just like that. And then ultimately they split. He split from the Belmonts, and then he went and picked some other guys, some of the best singers he could find on the streets. On the streets, he just found them on the streets, and they came in and became the Del Satins. And they backed him up there. And it's amazing. What a beautiful time in history, huh? Where people were just singing in the streets and on doorsteps, a cappella, and they were so talented, so talented. And you get this, and the recording and the musicianship is just all, it's all super tasteful and super talented. Great, great music, historically great music. Amazing. I didn't realize how good it was at the time. Well, beautiful song. Who knows where or when? Who knows where or when, right? But who knows where or this song is like from the like South Pacific, pre-World War II or something. I mean, it's got this unbelievable vibe to it. Unbelievable. And you realize, you know what? We seemed to have more of the peace of God back then, didn't we? People were more laid back. It's almost like there was like a beautiful breeze blowing through their lives. This beautiful soft breeze. And we have a soft breeze blowing right in the air right now. Lonely Teenager. Incredible song. I'm a lonely teenager. Yeah. Very spiritual song. Should I go home? I wonder if I should go home, or maybe stay out on my own. I'm a lonely teenager. I'd like to go back home where I belong. I know I'll be all right if I just stay out of sight. I wanna go home where I belong. Be-oh. He's got a high, he can go way up with his voice. I'd have to warm my voice up to do that. Because he's young. He's singing like he's 21 years old. Man. Oh, to be 21 and be Dion, right? But it crushed him. And he talks about it. How worldly success is so terrible. So terrible. And he was trying to prove to his parents that he was good, that's what he said. He wanted to compete to be number one, just to show that he wasn't just some, reject. He wanted to prove something to them. So he really was pushing to try to be the best he could be. And he talks about that, how you get caught up in the fast lane. I mean, he was really caught up in the fast lane. He's 21, 22, and he's just had like all these gold records suddenly start pouring out. And king of the New York streets. You know, he was the king of New York. At a young age, 21, 22, 23, like that. Now, we're just kind of chatting here to set the mood of just, you know, we're relaxed. We're in a good mood. I'm recovering from the meltdown of my expectations. Ah, just stopped. Must have run out of battery. The battery must have run out. Let me see. Yeah, it did. Okay. Cool. No more music. And now we can focus in. Just like that. It just runs on batteries and boom, stop. Which is fine. You see? And that's kind of like how the peace of God imperceptibly dawned upon me yesterday. It's just one moment the world is, you know, doubt, the play of doubt is there. And the next moment, everything is just imperceptibly smooth gentleness and softness and glory, the peace and peacefulness. It's like a peacefulness had descended upon the world, everything. Like a fog descends upon everything, you know, this gentle fog. It's like this gentle peace had, Jesus calls it peace beyond understanding, had descended upon me, or dawned upon me. Peace beyond understanding dawned upon me yesterday. And then, it kind of, during the day, it sort of wore off as the day went on, as the play of activity and doubt, you know, intense day of work took place. And then last night, the dreams were intense, and I woke up and just the drama in my dreams were so intense. It was just like one thing after the other, and I had such a difficult time trying to get to my practice. I'm in Apex Yoga, and wow, I had a really severely difficult time. And woke up, got up, and I felt lousy. And what it is, it's the shock, as we know. When a breakthrough like that happens, I've never experienced that before, to that extent. Not that long, and not that integrated into my life. You know, I was working and driving, and just I was on cloud nine, and so this really shook up the whole landscape of my expectations. And I'm paying the price for it today, but this, you pay the price for success. You pay the price. There's a price to be paid for sure. And so you have to be really a spiritual warrior to handle this. The backlash, the blowback, is the shock of your expectations just being thrown into absolute disarray. Yeah, really. Again, we're controlled by our expectations. And we're very familiar with our expectations, and we expect, we don't realize it, but we're on autopilot according to our expectations for the most part. And so we expect the life, our experiencing to go a certain way. And when it goes in a completely unexpected way, it was completely unexpected actually, it shakes you up. It shakes you up, really shakes you up. So the spiritual path is not easy at all. And what's lacking in the world is really clear explanations like we have here that are really direct and to the point and explaining why is it so difficult. Just throwing out non-dual quotes, you know, that doesn't get to it. It doesn't get to it. I mean, that's helpful, but it's not helpful enough. It's not helpful enough. You have to go much further than that, much deeper, and understand the whole dynamic of expectations and familiarity. And I never hear any teachers talk about that, you know? I just don't hear them talk about it. And it's just, wow, I can't hardly believe it, you know? It's all about expectations and familiarity and shock and having to block panic. The whole path is like this. And it requires tremendous endurance, discipline, courage, you know, to continue on. It's rough. I've had a real rough day. But I just laid low. I just laid low and just, got knocked out yesterday, and so I'm having to recover from that knockout. But still functioning fine. I mean, nothing's wrong. Everything's fine. But my expectations are not so sure. They say, am I okay? You know, when things go very different than you expect, even if everything's fine, you're not so sure it's fine. You're not so sure it's fine. And so this is the problem we all have on the spiritual path, and everybody's just waiting for some pill to come along to cure this problem. That will never happen. We wait in vain. We wait in vain, and we wait in the realm of hope and fear. We wait in the realm of hope and fear, and that's the drama. And that's the drama that disappeared yesterday for me. It disappeared. Disappeared. Came back in dreams the next morning with a vengeance. It's like, so I had to practice, and I have to go at it again and keep at it. But it's kind of like a workout. When you have a great workout, you're gonna feel it the next day, and maybe 2 days from now, even worse. But you know you're getting stronger, so you pay the price. It's like that. Those who work out can really apply this analogy. It's very much like that. And you can't get discouraged if you feel weak a certain day. I really feel weak. I can't hardly move. Because that's the price you're paying for all the great workouts that you're doing. And then down the road, one day, you'll suddenly feel like Superman or woman. You know, you'll just like say, wow, I'm just hopping around. Like I ran on the trampoline again today. I did 15 minutes yesterday, 5 minutes today. And it's just really toning my legs and core from the bottom, from the ground up. But I'm not jumping around, not real spry right now because I'm tired, I'm sore. But I know down the road, I'm going to be, hopping and skipping and jumping. That's for sure. If I just steadily, keep it up and keep on doing it. And it's the same with the spiritual path. It is very similar. Physical workout, spiritual workout. But it's not the same. In other words, if you just do physical workouts, that's not going to be spiritual workouts, right? And vice versa. But they have this similar dynamic to them of down periods because you've done so well that you're going to feel it. And there's no way around this. There's no way around it. And so if we're waiting for a way around it, we wait in vain. We wait in the hell of hope and fear. And that's the drama. And wow, did I experience a drama dream this morning where it just went from one thing to the another thing to another thing to another thing. And I realized, that it's not going to stop. It won't stop. It's just doubt. It's the play of doubt. It's the play of doubt. And no resolution to it. And I said, well, I got to step in here because I thought there'd be some resolution. But every time I thought there'd be a resolution, something in the dream arose which threw a monkey wrench into the resolution. And it just, I realized this just goes on and on. In fact, this is what we suffer from continuously in this world. Exactly this mental play that we have. Exactly this mental play. And I realized this mental play really is what people are living in this world. This is what they're living out. Is they're dreaming it. It's really a dream. It's a mental dream of doubt. And we have to... Apex yoga is a shift. It's very different than the other yogas. It's another phase of yoga. And you cannot really relate to it from the lower phases, or the other phases, we could say. You cannot really relate to it. That's a problem. But non-dual teaching helps us get to the apex phase, apex yoga phase. But it's irritating to talk about it to those in other phases because it's so simple. It's total non-resolution, you might say. We don't resolve anything. Everything is assuaged in its own intrinsic spaciousness already. And we just recognize that fact. So it's a shift in what we're recognizing. And when we recognize that, we realize nothing needs to be resolved. There's no drama at all taking place, actually. It's a shift in viewpoint, is all it is. It's a shift in viewpoint. And you've heard this many times in non-dual teaching. It's really a shift in viewpoint. It's not a resolution at the old viewpoint. You don't resolve the old viewpoint. You don't work within that viewpoint to resolve the drama. You shift your viewpoint. I call it shifting to the imperceptible. You shift your attention to what's imperceptible instead of what's perceptible. What's imperceptible. And because it's imperceptible, it's imperceptibly gentle, right? Everything's imperceptible. And that's experiencing God, actually. That's God. So that's the peace of God. So you don't do anything with the old viewpoint at all. You just let it be exactly as it is, without any resolution of the hope and fear at all. Without any resolution of the hope and fear at all. And you simply now decide to experience the imperceptible. And don't try to understand that analytically. It's a good way to at least point to it. You know, just it really flips your mind, doesn't it? To experience the imperceptible. Yeah, that's really a wow expression, actually. And so we're on it, and I'm having so many signs. It's just amazing. From Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, she's just pouring on these signs nonstop. So she's really active right now. Very, very active. So something's about to happen for sure. This world's about to pop. You know, it's But we have to, you know, keep on keeping on with what we do. I mean, there's nothing else for us to do. There's no magic pill to take, actually. Now, I don't know what the peace of God will do for others, you know, for those who have the peace of God. I don't know. But there's still going to be that backlash, you know, even if you get helped, because your expectations are just going to be quite shocked. Quite shocked. So you have to know how to manage your success. This is the key point in all the videos. It's about managing your success. How to manage your success. If you get that, who can stop you? What can stop you? Because you'll keep going back to success again and again and again, knowing that it has this, you know, backlash, a shock. Your expectations are shocked, and you're not really sure. Even if everything clicks into place, it's a changed landscape. And you're not sure how to navigate that landscape, right? So yeah, of course I'd say, well, my gosh, if the peace of God is upon me, how do I go about my life? Everybody will like me, you know. And people come out of the woodwork. And everyone is, you know, in a bizarre state of drama, you know. It's all bizarre. Like I said, it's like all psychotic. Everybody's kind of like psychotic in this world, actually. And they know it. They know it. See, underneath, they know it. But it's a pose that they're posturing. Trying their best to cope up with the play of doubt. But underneath, they know that there's something wrong with them. Things aren't, something isn't right. That they're biased. They've got a severe bias against certainty. And so, you know, it's like a ship of pirates, basically. It comes into shore and... but somehow they're able to... experience something, you know, experience certainty. Like if you go to Hawaii, you experience the island, the atmosphere there, and you come back and everybody says, "Wow, it was really nice. It was really, really nice. I wish I could have stayed there." That's what they all say, right? So the peace of God is like Hawaii in terms of, it's just like people want to say, "Oh, this everything feels so smooth." And the drama seems to be all smoothed out. It's all seems smoothed out. We talk about the battle in the world right now, which is really between capitalism and Marxism. Okay, capitalism and Marxism. And also, you might say, aggressive religion. Islam is very aggressive right now as far as religion goes. They have, so there's different factions in the world. Traditional, maybe they're, you could say they're very traditional, but there's some faction there, and there's this huge conflict. But I just say Marxism and capitalism. Keep it simple, really. There's this huge struggle going on, and people are there's so much antagonism. Well, this is analogy to the Kumbh Mela in 1946, I think. But the Kumbh Mela in India is a time when all the different religious groups from India get together, and they spend time together, and they work on resolving their differences, strengthening their ties, and it's something where, and a lot of great saints show up, and the saints help the people. They help resolve disputes. It's kind of a way of making sure that disputes don't fester, and they set themselves, right with God for the next 4 years. It's a really great tradition, a brilliant tradition. So Manana and my mom would go to the Kumbh Melas, and what would happen was sometimes a very severe disputes would break out between the heads of these. There's a number, quite a few of these renunciate yogic paths and traditions, and they sometimes they're at each other's throats a little bit. You sound familiar, right? I mean, Christianity, Islam, there's different factions that are, at each other's throats, historically. And so it's no different in India, and in Buddhism it's the same thing. So, but they get together, and what happened, what she would do, she'd set up this big tent, and then she'd invite all the leaders, the heads of these different groups. She would invite them into the tent. They come to pay their respects, and they'd all show up because they wanted to see her, because her charisma was just completely, unbelievable. And so they'd come into the tent, and they'd have all these arguments, they'd have all this stuff, they're really angry with one another. But as they just sat with her, she'd just sit there quietly, and they'd just sit and spend some time. And starting to rain. They would just absolutely forget what it was that they were arguing about. Totally forget. And they'd walk out, arm in arm, best friends, again, best friends, and they say, "My gosh, were we arguing about something? I don't remember." It would just, it obliterated what they were. The antagonisms would just be obliterated, and they'd say, "You know what? We really look forward to, the next 4 years of getting along with one another and sharing, the love of God, well, with one another." And like that. It was like that. Just so everything was smoothed out. So they felt that smoothed outness, that everything's perfect just as it is. No, there's nothing to be worried about at all, nothing to be angry about. Now, it wore off, but the over aftertaste was still there for probably a long time, and it helped everyone get along. It helped everyone get along. Just think about that. What a great culture that has figured that out, where you get together like that, and you just sit into it in a tent with the one who is the peace of God is totally upon them, and you walk out and you just, hey, no more antagonisms. Isn't that the way it should be? Isn't that the way it should be? Of course, you need these Dharma kings to do that. But you also need a situation where people are willing to do that. You get the Marxists and the capitalists in the same room with Sri Sri Nandamayama, and they would come out and say, you know what, how about we, let's let religious culture flourish here, and, you know, let's do good in that direction, and we're friends. We don't understand what their antagonisms really were in the past, and we realized that it was silly, you know, silly. What were we wasting time on? Let's get towards the peace of God. Everyone wants the peace of God. Let's work towards that, really. You know, it would be like that. They just realized, oh my gosh, how silly we've been. It was just a dance of doubt, was all it was. That's all. And that would be, you know, it would smooth out. It would smooth out. The more saints there are in the world, the more smoothed out it becomes, actually. The less saints, the more hostility is in the world. More hostility is in the world. To some extent, I mean, materialism brings about great hostility in everyone, actually. The drive for accumulation. The play of hope and doubt, the fearful play of hope and doubt, hope and fear, because they hope and fear, hope and doubt, yeah. You always are trying to grasp something. You know, it's like a life raft in the ocean, this turbulent ocean. You're looking for that, you know, so grab a hold of something. And so you grab a hold of your neighbor's land and possessions. You know, say, I need these. It's crazy what we do. So how does it go when the peace of God is really upon you in terms of others? I don't know. So those are the things that your expectations. You don't know what to expect. Really don't know what to expect. But I have to, you know, risk it. I have to risk it. No time to lose. There's no time to lose. I noticed something very interesting today. That the day that Jesus announced he had returned to the world, which I put down as the very end of April, between April and May, April 30th is a good date to use for that. And I believe it was April 30th. And he said, "I'm back, and I've come back to relate with all of you as a friend." And that's all he said. That was almost 2 years ago now. And I said, "I wonder what Anandamayi's birthday is." I forgot. Well, it's April 30th. It's April 30th. I said, "Wow, isn't that extraordinary?" You know, well, that can't be a coincidence, can it? I mean, that's really, really something. And who knows what Jesus' birthday is? It may well be April 30th as well. It's certainly not likely to be December 25th, actually. It's sometime in spring. Sometime in spring. So it might be April 30th. It makes sense that he would return. Perhaps he'd return on the day of his birthday, the day that he first appeared here in this world, April 30th, that he would make a return on April 30th. You know, the sheep are out grazing, the whole scene, the situation, people are trying to pinpoint. It's sometime in April, I believe, his real birthday. It's not December 25th. But wouldn't that be something if it was the same birthday as Sri Sri Nandamayama? I wouldn't doubt it. There's something about that day. Food, just to say wow about, you know, wow food. We don't do soul food. We do wow food here. Now the peace of God is so gentle. You can function fine. It doesn't interrupt your functioning. It's imperceptible. Imperceptibly gentle. And nothing happens to the world in terms of, you know, the Big Bang of enlightenment. It's not there at all. There's nothing like that. It's just your attention is just on this, you know, imperceptibleness. That's all. So imperceptibleness, by its very nature, is all-pervasive. All-pervasive. There's no drama there at all. There's no drama at all in God, actually. None. It's peace beyond understanding. So it's dawning upon me more, you know. I've been aware that it's very close, very, very close. I've been aware of that for quite some time, and it's dawning upon me. And then, you know, what do you do? Well, I don't know, but maybe just people like to hang out with you, you know, just kind of sit, something feels like really smooth and no drama. Seems to be an absence of drama. And we're all besieged by drama right now, aren't we? We're utterly besieged by it. Except for a few very wise ones who stay out of it. But even so, you know, the fish in the sea, the currents in the ocean are, you know, affect everyone. All the fish in the ocean are affected by the temperature of the ocean. The temperature of the ocean, it's warming up in terms of the emotional attitudes of the world are really, people are too wound up, really too wound up. So everyone needs to cool down. We all need to cool down. So I've been trying to cool everyone down, but it hasn't worked. Maybe the peace of God will help calm people down, calm us down, right? We just need to calm down. And it's really difficult for people, but we'll have to find out, you know, how does it help? We're really kind of pioneering this situation, especially in the West. I mean, I don't know where you go exactly in the West to actually experience this. There are some Western spiritual teachers, so maybe there's a few people that, you know, and some people go to them. I've never had the never done that, and Holy Spirit never told me to, so. We're aiming for something quite profound here. When you have Sri Sri Nandamayama as your role model, then you're talking about something very profound. That really where people really get a feel. You know, it's not intellect, it's a feel. That they get a feeling. They get a feeling. It's pretty cool to see these palm fronds moving in the breeze, isn't it? I just noticed that. I'm looking at it. And, you know, you could just be relaxed. And the feeling is just there. The peace of God is just there. It's not something you have to grasp intellectually. You don't have to strain and struggle with questions and hopefully we could do a good job of it, you know, at some point. And there's no reason why we can't. Just kind of sit quietly and relax quietly and block panic. Make sure, the feeling is there. You realize there's something, the peace of God really is real. And it's here. Wow. It's very shocking. And they do not go into this question mode of your mind. Just stay away from that. That's poison. Stay away from it. Don't doubt it. You experience it now. You're in shock. And when people are in shock, they can either go become real sort of agitated and start asking a lot of questions. They become hyper, or they go into the wow. So what we do is insist that we go into the wow. That's the discipline that is called here, is called upon here. Not questioning, not questions. There's no reason to question. What's present is present. What you're feeling is what you're feeling. People try to, what happens, it affects your expectations, and then the mind gets all agitated and starts trying to reestablish, you know, a new set of reestablish the expectations anyway. So they ask questions. They want answers, meaning, what should I expect? It doesn't work that way. You have to just say, well, wow is what I should expect on the spiritual path. In other words, this is going to happen again, and I'm going to be wowed again. Every day I'm wowed. I'm sure there'll be more, you know, tonight. It's just because I'm prepared for it and willing to go through it. And that's how you go fast. If you go into questioning, you're going into mental concepts, blocking the feeling, and then you've lost it. You know, you've lost it. You've gone astray. You have to be willing to feel aware of what's imperceptible. And feel that and be aware of it, and it's quite shocking. So there's no way around it. You have to put up with that which is quite shocking to you, to your expectations, and just let, and then allow that to just sit there and marinate in it. And your expectations, you'll find out that you don't need so many expectations. You don't need to frantically rebuild your expectations. You just get used to functioning with less and less expectations, which is actually better. So you have to just get familiar with having less expectations, and also having higher expectations, much higher for yourself. And actually, you start expecting that you don't even need to struggle with hope and fear. That's all. You're simply going to let it all just be, set it down all exactly as it is. The entire drama in your mind, just set it all down. And just shift to what's imperceptible, which is the presence and the peace of God, the peaceful presence of God, the gentle, soft, glorious, peaceful presence of God, which is imperceptible. Yeah, that's what you expect. You expect that more and more and more and more and more, and so you don't really expect much anymore in terms of drama and what to do about it. You don't expect that's going to be any what you do at all, what you're involved in at all. And you just lose interest in all that. So, the peace of God is not based on resolving anything at all. So you don't resolve doubt. You don't do anything to doubt at all. You just lose interest in perceptibility, concepts, thoughts, that. You just lose interest in it. And you shift, your attention shifts to that which is imperceptible. So you just leave it as it is. You leave all the play of doubt just as it is, unresolved. Because the ultimate resolution is you just lose interest in it, and you're back to what you really love. That's all. There can't be any other resolution to it than that. There can't be anything other than that. We're trying to engineer a resolution to it. Okay, that will never work. Because we'll still doubt that. There'll just be more of the play of doubt, actually. You realize in your dreams, you keep trying to structure and engineer and get something, that'll work. And that just keeps going on and on and on and on, and never resolves at all. It never resolves. Longchenpa talks about that quite a bit in Song of the Enchanting Wildwoods, when he gets into some of the explanations. Could look at this a little bit. He says, having thus internalized the nature of all that is, sit upright on a comfortable seat with the body at ease and cultivate bodhicitta, concerned with the needs of all beings. He was talking about in nature, you see how everything comes to an end. Everything dies. And you realize, oh, this is the dream of doubt. I don't really want that. And as long as my attention's on that, that's what I'm going to get. It's there's no way around it. So he says, once you really internalize and recognize this, you sit upright on a comfortable seat, like we're doing here, with the body at ease, which we're doing here, and cultivate bodhicitta, concerned with the needs of beings. Don't dwell on the past or fantasize about the future. Don't dwell on the past. Now, when I'm doing this practice, I am an apex yogin. It's so successful that I get shocked, the expectations shock, and I start having these fantasies of wonderful future, a wonderful future where, the world is saved from its backsliding, saved from darkness. There's a huge revival, the entire world, a massive revival, and everybody turns it around. So I have these wonderful dreams, daydreams about the future. But he says, don't dwell on the past or fantasize about the future. Okay, so I realize, wow, you got to stop that. Don't engineer this natural ongoing presence. So that the natural ongoing presence, which we call God, don't try to engineer it in any way. Don't try to engineer it. Don't direct the mind or draw it within. Don't direct the mind or draw it within. Don't try to draw it within somewhere. Just let it settle without distraction. Just let it settle. And practicing saying something over and over, just one thought, one saying, I'm an apex yogin, wow. This lets all other doubts just settle down, because you're not engaging with them at all. You're not, our attention, like the wind causes leaves to blow up in the air, our attention causes doubt to spring into action like a drama. But we take all our attention off of it, we're just disinterested in it, it all settles down. Resting without grasping or conceptually structuring this open clarity, just rest in this open clarity without trying to grasp or conceptually structure it at all. Don't try to grasp it. I say it's imperceptible. There's nothing to grasp. And it's imperceptible. There's nothing to conceptually structure at all. Just rest in this open clarity. This open clarity that is vivid, quiet, lucid, illuminating. This is the wisdom intent of the Buddhas of the three times. So it's vivid, quiet, lucid, illuminating. But what I experienced is that it's soft, gentle, peaceful, like that. Other than settling, easily relaxed, in the innate experience of the way your mind abides, there's nothing you need to contemplate. You don't need to be fixated on contemplating something. You're just resting naturally in open clarity. So you can release the effort it takes to engineer it. You release the effort to engineer some sort of resolution to doubt, resolution to the drama, some sort of success where you have positive drama and everyone's cheering, say, all right, we got this positive outcome now. You don't need to engineer anything. For it is not an object of conceptual elaboration. It is not an object of conceptual elaboration. That's why I call it, it's imperceptible. It's imperceptible. So you cannot see any conceptual elaboration at all. It can never be an object of conceptual elaboration. It can't be conceived of or investigated. It cannot be conceived or investigated. Yet, it is the wisdom intent of the Buddhas. That's what their intent is, to get, to experience this. Therefore, to quiet the tangled mess of thought, which is really just doubt, the dance of doubt, all you need to do is look into the intimately peaceful nature of mind. The intimately peaceful nature. That's a nice phrase. Intimately peaceful nature of mind. That's all you need to do. So you shift your attention to the imperceptible, intimate, peaceful nature of mind. At the end of the session, dedicate without reifying the three spheres. Don't concretize what it is that the world, you might say, the three spheres of maybe what he's saying, body, mind, speech. Don't try to concretize them based on this experience that you've had, In between sessions, cultivate your appreciation of impermanence and death. Conditioned things have no attainable essence and are rife with problems. Consider how samsara's nature is also like this. The dance of doubt, samsara. Once you have realized how the play of all external appearance are like a dream or illusion, let everything be within the equality of the experiential dimension of space. The equality within the experiential dimension of space. The imperceptibility, the equality within imperceptibility. The imperceptible. Don't affirm or reject anything. Now this is the wow, as we say here. Full stop in the wow. What he's really talking about is full stop on the wow. Don't affirm or reject anything. That's what I say. When you have this experience, don't say, yeah, I affirm this, or, oh, I reject this. Do not get into that mode of trying to stabilize it. Just say, wow. Just say, wow. I neither affirm it nor reject it. I neither accept it or reject it. I neither affirm it nor deny it. Okay? Give up attempting to engineer experience. Give up attempting to engineer experience. We've been trying to engineer experience in the play of doubt. Constantly trying to engineer experience so that the doubt feels righteous to us. Somehow we feel righteous, trying to engineer righteousness. By living in this fashion, when you do not attempt to engineer experience, living in this fashion, it will help reveal the unborn and unceasing nature of mind. The unborn and unceasing nature of mind. Your innate nature just as it is. Your innate nature just as it is, without trying to engineer the experience at all. Also, at night, when it is time to sleep, release your mind into a conceptually unstructured experience. Within the reality of its unborn nature. When you wake and appearances dawn, repeatedly relate them as being ineffable by nature like illusions. Ineffable by nature like illusions. All is imperceptible, completely imperceptible. Once you have seen this precious treasury of your mind's nature to be such that nothing need be added or removed, you will cross the painful ocean of existence to the simple experience of that which is eternally peaceful. Do you hear that? To the simple experience of that which is eternally peaceful, the peace beyond understanding, the peace of God, and entails no suffering, arriving at the boundless state of Buddhahood. Arriving at the boundless state of Buddhahood. Christians, so would say, the vision of Christ. Vision of Christ. Boundless state of Buddhahood. The peace that passeth all understanding. That's what we, are getting used to, you know, we're getting familiar with this. That's the goal, familiarity with that, interest in that. And no more interest in the fearsome ocean of doubt, dance of doubt. And doubt is merely just doubting certainty. That's all it is. And doubt is never certain about its doubt. Okay, it's never certain about it. Doubt. How can doubt be certain about doubt? It always doubts itself, doesn't it? Doesn't doubt always doubt itself too? Yes, this is a very key recognition when you see that doubt also doubts doubt. It doubts itself. It doubts doubt too. So it's never at rest. It's never at rest. It can't come to rest in certainty about doubt. It cannot. It cannot. There's no certainty in doubt. And this is why this dance of doubt continues and continues, and we never can resolve it at the level of doubt. It's impossible. We never can reach certainty within the level of doubt. Well, it's fortunately it's not so cold that I don't want to tape. I'll be able to do it. This heat pad was a great wonderful thing. I put it on. It keeps me warm for about an hour. At least it helps. I wish it would last longer than an hour, but that it helps a lot. It helps a lot. So I'm able to tape outside at night here, where everything is settled down and. And we don't want to go to bed. We don't want to just reach the doldrums, right? 8 o'clock at night. And what do you do? What do you do until you go to bed? Most people watch television. Huge mistake. Huge mistake. I used to listen to baseball games. Big mistake also, actually. Gets you all jazzed up and tense. Because baseball games can be very, very excruciating. The tension, it builds and builds. It becomes excruciating. And so what do you do, right? Some people eat. So they just eat until I go to bed. Or some listen to music, some watch YouTube. YouTube, going to YouTube. That's our Facebook. Now people go into Facebook, which is, that's the Facebook's the dance of doubt also, really. I mean, it's a jungle. It's really a jungle. You just can't seem to, nobody seems to be able to really weed it out very well, really. It just can't, because everybody is trying to structure, engineer some certitude within doubt, and that doesn't work, and it will never work, and they're all hoping, and it's, I haven't gotten anywhere on Facebook. I really have not gotten anywhere at all. I'm right back down to, ground zero. I do a post, a wonderful post of wisdom, and, one comment, or zero views or something. Back to zero. You put up a picture of Sri Sri Nandamayama, and you get lots of likes, for sure. But in terms of passing on this wisdom that we have here, it doesn't get any traction at all. And this is wisdom here. This is part of wisdom cultures. This is dharmic. This is very dharmic. Okay, it's part of the dharma, and there should be a sangha, that hears this, because it's right on point. It's right on point. We're experiencing the path instead of talking about it. We're experiencing it. The path has to be experienced. Talking about it, I always often say, it's like stretching before running a marathon. And you got a lot of stretchers out there. And not many are running the marathon. And running the marathon's tough. There's some hills, and I mean, you got to feel it, right? And you got to adjust to not being suboptimal on a marathon. You're going to feel like, wow, can I keep going? I don't know. I've never run one, but I've run a spiritual marathon my whole life. It's been just one huge spiritual marathon. And I decided to go for it. I said, well, should be very, very challenging. And it has been. Very much so. But what else was I going to do? Play piano? Yeah. What was I going to do? What would I do with that in today's world? Play piano in a band if I wanted to go back to being a virtuoso pianist, and I don't know, go around playing bars, casinos. What are you going to do with playing piano? I mean, so not so many, you know, might be a few places with culture, big cities still have, you know, you can play concerts, just a piano, but I've been there and done that, so I can't do that for another lifetime, no way. So what am I going to do? What am I going to do? You know, why not try something challenging? Really challenging, that really, you know, is a real adventure. And it has been a real adventure. It's been so much, such an amazing adventure. People don't know what they're missing. Really. If they did, they'd do it themselves. Because otherwise, really, life is quite boring and then it's over. It's over with. It's like that. What did you do? Well, I watched, you know, some game shows for 30 years. Or, you know, what did I do? And now it's over. Wow. You know? That's what happens. Make some friends along the way, have a few houses, you know, go to different places, have a few vacations, read a few inspiring books, get sick and die. But in my case, every day is just this, I mean, I'm just hanging on for dear life. The progress is so amazing. I'm just in shock most of the time, actually. Most of my life I've been in shock. But coming out of it too, and then having these amazing breakthroughs, and then the shock of that, and then coming out of that, and, you know, and just having these clarifications and insights that are just like, wow, how tremendous it is to get to this and see it this way, you know, see it this way, changing the way your viewpoint, you know, your entire viewpoint on everything, changing your viewpoint on everything in ways that you could never have imagined, really. That's a lot of fun. And those who have experienced this know what I'm talking about. You know, you don't want to stop, right? I mean, you want to keep doing that. You really want to keep doing it. The only goal should be the peace of God. That's it. Don't have any other goals on the spiritual path. Don't have any other goals. Just that. Just that. And you'll go much, much faster. You won't be waylaid by all these side trips. You know, psychic, spiritual powers, psychic powers. You know, how can you do this? How can you do that? Explain this to me. I want to sort of attain this meditational state. I want to be able to get this quality or virtue in my life. All that stuff, just forget about all that. It's all nonsense. Just aim for the peace of God. Peace that passeth all understanding. And that's what Longchenpa is pointing directly to here. It's called apex yoga. Apex yoga is you just go for the peace of God and nothing else. And you do that by experiencing the peace of God, not by struggling with doubt, hoping to win at doubt somehow. Again, doubt always doubts. It's never certain. Don't try to get over on anyone. Be smarter, be, you know, more capable than them or something like that. Just go for the peace of God, nothing else. And that vastly simplifies your path. And you'll find all these questions you have, really, you don't need to even pursue them at all. You lose interest in all that stuff, all that spirituality, I call it. You lose interest in spirituality, the vast swamp of spirituality. That's just trying to make doubt pretty, basically. That's all it's trying to do. Trying to structure, engineer doubt in some way that we think we'll like. That's all that it is. That's all that it is. Playing with perception. That's not really the path. That's not really the path. You know, it's magical, magic. You know, magic's not the spiritual path at all. Magical belief. You have to decide that that's not what you really want. And when you decide that, then you decide that what you're really after is this amazing piece that Longchenpa knows about so well. You're just after that. Get that first, and then see if you want something else. Get this, get it first. Get it, and then, you know, then we'll see if there's all sorts of other stuff we really want. So again, the bottom line is even though the peace of God is so seamlessly smooth and gentle, there's no trouble functioning at all. In fact, you feel your functioning is better than before. It's such a shock to your expectations that you're gonna feel kind of out of sorts for a little while. It's not so bad. I've gotten through it. But I did feel out of sorts. But I'm in good enough shape. Somehow being in good shape seems to help out. That I sort of have confidence. Like even if I feel terrible like this, I know I'm still strong enough to do what I need to do. My core is real strong. So that has helped out. I'm doing my paddling exercises. I did it today, and wow, that's very unique motion that gets muscles that ordinarily you aren't gotten. So that's why if you try to surf, you haven't surfed before, your arms will just feel dead, and you just like feel dead in the water. That's why the surfers just surf all the time. They get so good because their paddling they do it all so strong. Their paddling, they can go so fast, and that helps you get into waves early, and also keeps you from getting caught inside and again having waves close out on you. You're able to paddle really fast when you need to. They call it scratch out. It go real fast. And they don't wear down. And so I'm practicing these paddling exercises. And so I'm just going to try to keep doing that, you know, every day and more so I can build up some paddling strength. I'd like to get out to surf sometime. actually surfed in my dreams a couple nights ago. And I was like in the dream, I said, whoa, I'm surfing. The first time I surfed in a long time, actually doing it. I was in a dream. I was on this smallest wave, but I caught it, and I was standing up, and I was surfing, and I was like so excited. I said, oh my gosh, I'm surfing again. I was in a dream. Maybe that has to do with the peace of God, you know, surfing again. Gliding in a, you know, in this smooth way, just gliding sort of effortlessly. It's there's some force that's just pushing you. You're not having to propel yourself. The energy of the ocean is pushing you now, and you're able to glide along this wave, the energy of the ocean. It just keeps you going and going and going, and it's like you're like, wow, this is amazing. You know, it's so great. It's quite an experience riding waves, actually. It really is. So maybe that was a precursor to this experiencing the peace of God. It's like, wow, I was able to get up on the board, stand up on the board, and I could stand it. You know, I was able to stand it and keep my balance on the board. And I was surfing again, which is an analogy for experiencing the peace of God. And very likely that was it, because it happened a couple days before. So really, it's just a matter of being really desiring the peace of God and blocking out other stuff and just not paying attention to it anymore. You really just have to take your attention off the world more and more and more. And just don't follow it. I don't follow the world. I don't follow what people do. I mind my own business. I let them mind their own business. I'm not aware of what they're doing with their lives. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Let those who crave doubt, who are interested in doubt, let them deal with the dance of doubt, which is the world. Let the dead bury the dead. Let those who want to believe in doubt, let them deal with the dance of doubt. I don't believe in doubt, and I don't feel I need to fix the world. That's for those. It's just a dream of doubt, and there's always going to be doubt cropping up. It just goes on and on and on, and there's no fixing it, actually, at all. There's no fixing it. There's no way to fix the world. There's no way to fix the world at all. How do you fix doubt? What kind of doubt fixes doubt? That too will be doubted. And it's no fix at all. So there's no way to fix the world at all. And the more you think you can, cleverly, you know, people say, well, let's just make a little better. But that's still an attempt to fix the world, actually. It's a clever attempt, we say. Maybe if we just don't do too much, it'll be okay. No, even that's not okay. So just don't worry about fixing it. Let those who want it struggle with it. You don't have to struggle with it. I try not to think about what are people thinking? What are they doing? Just drop that. It doesn't matter what they're thinking. That's doubt. What are they doing? That's doubt. You know, it doesn't matter. It never resolves. It never resolves. So why even pay attention to it? It never resolves itself. It never resolves. It all dissolves away. Equally, let everything dissolve away, but it never resolves. There's no resolution. So does that mean you're not interested in people and persons? Yeah, personalities, yeah, it means that. I'm not interested in people at all, personalities or anything like that. That's just a dance of doubt. That's not spirit. It is spirit doing a dance of doubt, pretending that, you know, doubt, trying to pretend doubt is real. So you don't have to pay attention to people. Ananda Mayama was very detached, extremely, supremely detached and aloof in a lot of ways. Where she really, people say, wow, it's like we don't even, she's not paying to our personalities or person paying any attention to it at all. She's focused on something else entirely. And she said she didn't even see bodies. Bodies never appeared to her. A globe of golden light, beautiful golden light is how she saw us. So she didn't even pay attention to bodies at all. And so she would, most of the time, you know, just be in this supremely detached state where she seemed to be, you know, in a different world or universe dimension, are just, you know, so far gone from the world. She only paid attention to, you know, spiritual teaching and truths and that. But at the same time, aware of everybody's struggles. But it's interesting. But we do not have to, we could be aware of troubles without any fixation upon it or any interest in it. Any interest in it. I'm not even interested in my life and my personality, what becomes of my personality. So also be disinterested in yourself as well, your personality, your personal self, so to speak. Become totally disinterested in that also, because it never resolves. It just continues, you know, like an ocean, like a stormy ocean. It just, the winds keep blowing and the ocean keeps storming. That's all. There's no resolution to it. As long as the wind blows, there's no resolution to it. And when the wind stops blowing, the entire ocean calms down. Everything just naturally settles down, like a stormy ocean with the winds becomes completely calm. It all just naturally just settles down and becomes glassy, actually. Yeah, I miss the glassy ocean. I used to surf and go early in the morning when it was just totally glassy. I mean, I experienced such beautiful oceans. I mean, it's just, we'd get there at first crack of dawn and go out and just the quiet, the stillness and the quiet, the glassiest of the ocean, and then the waves, the sound of the waves breaking. And it was just a very surreal experience. So surreal. I mean, I'd like to do that. And then the afternoon, the winds come, the temperature differentiation between the land and the ocean kicks up, you know, either onshore or offshore winds, and then it gets all choppy, and, you know, it's all blown out and choppy, and you go there in the late afternoon, look at the ocean, it's not so aesthetically pleasing, but early in the morning, when everything is just still and dewy, and you know, wow. I mean, I would love to be out there again, especially in warm water. I've never surfed in warm water. It's always been freezing water of Northern California. It's beautiful. And how does it happen from overnight that the ocean gets all glassy like that? Well, because no more wind. As the land balances out with the ocean as far as temperature goes and gets cools off, then the wind calms down, and a lot of times during the night that, you know, there's no wind blowing, and then the whole ocean just what was choppy 10 hours ago, you know, is now just like glass. Now, it could get choppy again if the wind blows again. So we can return to doubt if we want to. So is doubt resolved? No. It's just we lose interest and it all settles down and we no longer entertain doubt. That's all. But if we want to entertain it then we'll doubt again. But you can't kill doubt. You know, the mind can always doubt itself. You know, doubt that it is what it is. And believe that it's something different. It doesn't change the mind. We're just doubting that the mind is what it is, but it still is that. I mean, you can doubt whatever you want to. You can doubt that your car's in your driveway, but you go out and oh, it's there. You know, so doubt is not causative. Doubt is not causative. It's just a desire to try to pretend to be uncertain. Which is really an attempt to change what we are, which is an attempt to be greater than God. That's what it is. wonder if I can move that battery around and get Dion back on the vibes here. How many batteries are there in here? Two. Sometimes you can move them around, and it sort of gets them going again. I will try that. Oh yeah, it worked. The wind is blowing again, or I don't know. It seems to have worked. Let me see. Or maybe not. Maybe it's slowing down and stopping. It didn't really work. It stopped. So it started up and then stopped. So the batteries really are kaput. I'll just shift the order of the batteries. And a lot of times works, but that's not working this time. So that means a very efficient use of the energy of the battery. Let's go again. Okay, it's going again, but will it play? Yeah, playing this time. That's amazing. Love came to me. Peace came to me. Peace of God came to me. It's a great song by Dion and the Belmonts. I lived in dreams. Strange as it seems, love came to me. It's that one. When I opened my eyes. Now it stopped again. So at least we got enough there. Love came to me. I lived in dreams, but strange as it seems, love came to me. So we had just enough juice left in those batteries to hear that snippet. I lived in dreams, strange as it seems, love came to me. So we've been living in dreams. Dreams of doubt, but strange as it seems, peace of God came to me. And it does seem kind of strange. You're like, wow. What is this? Wow. This is unusual. And the less that culture talks about it, the more unusual, unfamiliar it seems to us. Whereas if many people talk about and experience it, you'll say, oh, I know what this is. This is the peace of God. And you say, okay, great. So that's why it's so disastrous to get away from this and get into these battles of economic battles, you know, that were political, you know, ideational battles of the world, New World Order, you know, trying to engineer some happiness in the world. Happiness comes from peace of God, and we get to that by the more we talk about it, the more we familiarize it within culture, the easier it becomes. And the less we familiarize it in culture, the more difficult it becomes. This is why we're living such a disastrous time. I don't know how we're going to turn it around. It's just we become political animals. And I always say, the worst thing that ever happened is women getting the vote because they've turned into political animals. They're most political of all now. I mean, they're just animals, political animals. And they're not passing on religious culture anymore to everyone. I mean, their children, their nieces, their grandchildren, their cousins, their nieces, their nephews, their, you know, just the whole extended relational family, they're not passing on anymore. They're talking politics. They're talking hate all the time. And this destroys culture. The reason why women didn't have the vote, because they're too important for culture to get involved in the viciousness of politics. Politics is vicious. And you can't have women putting all their attention on this viciousness as they are now. That destroys spiritual culture. So yeah, I would not have women vote. I would not have them vote. Not that they're not capable. They're very bright and capable of all that stuff. But because they have a more important role in culture. They have a crucial role in culture to make sure that that religious education, that we stay familiar with the fact that the peace of God can come upon us. And they're capable of doing that. They've done it historically. Women have done this historically. So leave the fight, the wrangling, the politics to men. Leave it to men. They tend to be able to handle that better because they can let bygones be bygones. They don't get quite caught up in it. Women get so caught up in it. They want everything to be right. Like, it's like their family is squabbling, and it just drives them nuts. And this is what's happened. Women have just been driven crazy by politics. Men, not so much. We don't really talk about it very much, actually. I mean, if someone says a political mark, we just kind of go, and we get back to work. You know, we don't really talk about it much at all. But women, they just activism, not that they just, we got to get our family working again. You know, we got to get everybody's got to be happy. So for women, everything's their family, and so when they can't stand, you know, the conflict of politics, which is inherently conflictual. It's inherently conflictual because nothing really satisfies us. And so, but men have a capacity to understand that and say, well, we don't really need to iron everything out, you know? Sure, there's some problems here, but just let it be. So they're much better at politics than women. They're much, much better. That's why historically this is the way that it's been. They don't try. They don't care. They'll wear a wrinkled shirt, okay, and wrinkled pants, and it's just fine. It's okay. How do I look? Yeah, you look okay. So the women want to iron out all the wrinkles, and you can't do that in politics. And this is, it's become an obsession with culture, a cultural obsession. So again, I say the worst thing that ever happened with culture is giving women the vote. The worst thing that ever happened. I'm probably the only person in the world who will say that, but it's absolutely true. If you look at reason and look at it from a spiritual standpoint, it's exactly true. And you know, feminism is wrong. They're wrong. What they did was they tried to compete with men in a sphere where men are much more better suited for it, and they abandoned the extremely important role of transmitting spiritual culture. You know, they're the hub of spiritual culture, women in the family. They're the hub of it, and they abandon it. And it's caused the collapse of this world, actually. I mean, men could get in a fight and then afterwards shake hands and have a beer, you know? It's just like, say, okay, what are we fighting about? I don't know. Is this good enough for you? Yeah, okay, it's good. Men and women are different. And feminists refuse to acknowledge that, you know. They're just stupid, is all you can put. Just absurd. They're just absurd. And it's just everywhere. Obviously, they're messed up. They've messed up the world. Extremely so. But they keep thinking, no. If we just we'll get the resolution. If we just kill our enemies, we'll get the resolution. If we just win, you know, we got to have it. It doesn't work that way. It never works that way, okay? They don't understand. It's kind of like getting everyone to get along in a family. I mean, it just doesn't work, but they never stop trying, do they? They always try to get the family together can we just finally make peace with one another and we all love one another? You know, and they want that to happen. Well, the same thing with politics. But politics is dangerous to do that. Very, very dangerous to do that. You have to understand. Throughout, of course, men have paid the price for that throughout history and with wars and such. And so you have to respect the differences and realize you're not going to get along and still be very diplomatic and civil and find what you can do, and it's a very tricky thing, and you need the temperament for it. You need to be very thick-skinned, really thick-skinned. And men are, you know, way better at it than women, way, way better. Women have no business in politics, no business at all. They really don't. They do a lousy job, a very lousy job. I don't know what people are looking at. I mean, it's so obvious. It's so obvious what's gone on. But they do a great job with transmitting culture. They do a great job, way better than men, in terms of really ingraining it, you know, over and over with patience, and they keep at it, and they keep at it for a lifetime. You know, and look what happens when they stop doing that. The world falls apart. The world has fallen apart because they've stopped doing that. Men can't do that. I can't fix it. I can't fix culture. Women have this, you know, I just see women hanging out with their young children. I say, wow, they're so willing to just be there with them and watch patiently, allow them to mature, you know, and just because they know it's going to take time. I mean, you can't have your little baby grow up immediately and they watch the kids fall and do all that stuff. They just allow, you know, have the kids with them, and they're so patient and willing to allow the process to take place of growing. And men don't have that quality, you know. They're so as much, they're not as good at it. I mean, any man that says he's as good a mom as a good mom is not true. Just like a woman says she's just good politically as a man, that's not true at all. It's not true at all. There are a few anomalies, but that just drives home the point all the more. They're anomalies, and the idea of making policy on anomalies is crazy. So, you know, just women should say, you know what, we're tired of politics. I think there may come a day when they say, forget it. You know, we're going back to the family, and this just didn't work for us. You know, that would be a great day. That would be a great day when that happens. And then spiritual culture will reassert itself. You got to keep politics out of the family. You got the family's a haven from the world. It should be a haven from the world. You can't have the women bringing the world into the family like the way they're doing now. I mean, they're just out of control right now. Out of control. They're so activist, and just thinking that it's you know, up to them to do everything in the world. But of course, there's no resolution. There's no fixing the world at all. So the goal has to be the peace of God. When you lose sight of the goal, you're just headed for disaster. You're headed for more drama than any of us can tolerate. When women lose sight of what the goal really is and they think that they need to fix the world and get into politics, you're headed for a complete meltdown in the world. And that's what we're at right now. So you're hearing what nobody's willing to say, and I don't have any friends, so I have nothing to lose. You see, that's part of the genius of God, not giving me any friends. I have a few, social media friends, and that I consider friends, but as far as, you know, actually socially hanging out with people, I don't have any friends. So. I'm not worried about losing friends. I'm not really worried about it. I just speak the truth. And I guarantee you there are a lot of women that deep down they understand exactly what I'm saying. And a lot of traditional women say, you know what, it's terrible what's happened. Absolutely terrible. Feminism was absolutely the devil itself. And it really is the devil itself. A way to plunge this world into severe turmoil and for us to lose sight of what the goal of existence really is. As Ram Maharshi said, to turn within and realize the self is the only useful use of your life. The only one. Nothing else is will be of value to you. That's it. That's it. That's it. The only useful the only proper uses of your life is to turn within and realize the self. Nothing else is. Nothing else is. It will be useful to you. It's Ram Maharshi. They all say that. All the Dharma kings say it. That's it. That's it. So if we drop the ball, that ball, we're just headed for chaos. We're headed for chaos. And we are headed for chaos in this world. We're headed for chaos. And again, a lot of conservative women fought against it and tried to prevent it because they knew what would happen. But unfortunately, they were unable to prevent it. Now, they've been swept up in it. Most of them have been swept up in it to some extent because, you know, it seems irresistible. I mean, where else can you go? They've just, the ones that are trying to hold out, you know, it's a very valiant effort on their part. they make certain that, that their children really, really are schooled in, you know, the purpose of life as best that they know it. And they ask the husband to, you know, talk about it and hammer it home. And then when the husband's off to work, guess what? There she is reinforcing it with the kids. Every little lesson of the child, she's there to, you know, help the child remember that, call upon God. You know, everything's the grace of God. Remember what your dad said. Everything's the grace of God. And so they work together like that. But the mother is there with the, all the time with the child. And this is invaluable, 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 invaluable. And not having that, catastrophe. Social, cultural, civilizational catastrophe. And unfortunately, we've not been able to prevent it. I hoped to prevent it. I tried to point out what was wrong with, and nobody listened. You know, as Longchenpa says in the Song of the Enchanting Wildwoods, is you get to a point where nobody listens. You know, he talks about it very clearly, and we're at that point right now. When explained well, nobody pays attention. Poor explanations contradict the true Dharma. Since beings prefer to believe that the Buddhas have taught only that they should do what they like and nothing else, when I teach the real Dharma way, everybody reviles me like an enemy. For whatever reason, they teach non-Dharma these days. People love it, even though it sends them off to the lower realms. I simply can't understand what they're up to. Seeing all this, since I aim to accomplish the benefit of beings, I can't stay. I won't stay. I'm going to the wild woods. Maybe Longchenpa is all over it. He knows exactly what's going on. That's why he showed up and asked for help. He knows exactly what's going on. Now, the Dharma kings don't say stuff, controversial stuff at all, because then we feel that we would have to then, you know, teach that, share that with others, which would be too difficult for us. I mean, I'm like, you know, one in a billion in terms of what I'm saying. Nobody else has the guts to say it. They won't say it. So if Jesus taught this in the Course in Miracles, and you think you'd have to teach that, you would drop a Course in Miracles. You say, oh my gosh, you know, I can't do it. So I think that's why they don't say any of this stuff. But you can bet by what Longchenpa said there, he knows exactly what these times are all about. Exactly what they're all about. Okay, so do you get that? Just because they don't say it doesn't mean they're not aware of it. But they don't want to put the pressure on us. That would be unbearable pressure if Jesus puts in A Course in Miracles. And by the way, folks, women should not vote. They shouldn't be engaged in politics at all. How would that Course in Miracles be circulated successfully around the world? It would be crushed. Women, the feminists would have crushed it. And the people who read it would feel so scared, you know, they would be so attacked so severely, they would just abandon it. They would abandon it. So he didn't say anything about it. Same with electronics. They don't say anything about it. But I say it because I'm, you know, again, I don't have any friends, and not many are listening, and I'm very tough minded, but not so tough that I go around telling people directly this. I don't tell people directly this because that's too much. It is too much. People think you're like evil, you know, like you just said the worst thing in the world. Actually, you just said like the wisest thing in the world. But people are so upside down and backwards. You know, they love non-Dharma. They think non-Dharma is the Dharma. And Longchenpa explains this perfectly in this beautiful poem that he brought to my attention right on time. And I read that, I said, oh my God, I was weeping. I said, oh my gosh, he knows exactly what's going on. And he's telling me, you know, you're going to have to retreat from this situation here in the world. I mean, let me ask you this. Do you really think that tomorrow morning we'll wake up and all the women, everyone's going to pass a law on the countries of the world that women no longer are allowed to vote? Do you really think that's going to happen? And they're no longer allowed to run for political office? That's not going to happen, is it? It's not going to happen. My wife, fortunately, says she just, well, I don't want to do what she says, but she, quote unquote, agrees with me. She said, "Don't tell anybody, you know, about this." She thinks men do a better job at politics. She says, "I think men are much better at politics, and women shouldn't be in politics. They don't. Men are way better at it." Well, yeah, of course. That's just, it's obvious. It's not like some big pronouncement. It's like, I think, you know, men can hit a baseball farther than women, or throw a baseball overhand faster. Yeah, you know. But for some crazy reason, women are trying to physically compete with men. I mean, that is so stupid. And they've abandoned what they do best. They've abandoned it. They say, "I want to run as fast as a man runs." You know, that's their goal. That's idiocy. You know, it's so, such a waste of life. Why are genders competing? Why, men don't want to compete with women. I don't want to compete. It's stupid. But women are obsessed with competing with men. It's their obsession. It's not our obsession. And they've convinced us that we're supposed to help them do that. No, I want to, you know, wrestle, you know, men. I want to wrestle men. I want to, you know, fight men. I want to, you know. Men don't want to do that. Now, what are you talking about? I mean, you're just overlooking. You know, do what you do best. And we'll do what we do best, and everything will work out a lot better that way. A lot better. And yet, you know, they've got their kids at daycare, and they're out furiously in gyms trying to, like, you know, get these massive muscles so they're, like, as strong, as muscularly strong as men. You know, just talk, you know, it's just absurd. So arrogant, you know, so arrogant. And absurd. Yeah, what could you say? There's a guilt trip. They know they've abandoned their children. Or maybe they're tired of having children and don't want to have any more, and they want to be more like men and care less about children. You know, that's also a possibility. And I don't blame them. I don't blame them. I mean, I think women should be tired of having children. I mean, isn't it enough enough? Isn't it time we graduate from birth and death? So maybe that's part of it. They're saying, if I could just be more like a man, maybe I can care less about my kids. It's working, but that part's working, but the caring less about kids, well, someone else is caring about them, which is, you know, the devil, so to speak, you know? Devil's caring a lot for your kids, and we're forgetting what the goal of existence is, which is really just a dance of doubt. We're forgetting that, so it really hasn't worked well. It's worked very poorly, but yeah, I mean, I'm all for women not having children. If they don't want to have children, that's great. That's a real severe dedication, isn't it? Lifelong dedication there. You really have to have your heart in it. It's very difficult. But I know the way to be free of birth and death. You know, when the peace of God comes upon you, you're free of conditioned existence. And you won't return here. You will not return here. So you're done with, yeah, giving birth and having children and all that. You're done with it. It's over with. And women want a bigger role in every aspect of society, but they're overlooking what really works for them. They can have the peace of God as well if they do what really works for them, instead of trying to compete with men and gain positions of leadership and all that kind of stuff. It doesn't work well. You know, men are really tired of all this leadership stuff too, and warrior stuff and working. We want to be free of that too. maintaining all the hard labor we do. Are you kidding me? I want to be free of that, absolutely free of it, and I will be. So we're all weary of this world, but we're not going to get free of it by you know, this women thinking that men are weary of leadership, so they it's their opportunity to jump into it and seize power. You know, that's not the right thing to do. They should say, wow, well, let's redouble our efforts to get the peace of God then. Let's all redouble our efforts instead of this ridiculous, what's happened over, you know, over the last 100 years is just all wrong. It's all wrong. It's a disaster. Wow, some rain got through the roof somehow. That's not good. How'd that happen? I don't know. Or was it blown in here somehow? And we shouldn't, again, use anomalies to try and rally a movement. That's, again, very, very absurd. Sri Sri Anandamayi totally supported male spiritual leaders, never tried to subvert them, was always subservient to them in terms of let them do their job. She never tried to interfere with them doing their job at all, at all. When they tried to bring her up on stage, says, hey, you take over, you know this better than we do, she said, no. This is, that's your role, okay? You got to learn to do your role better. So she came to tell the men, you do your role better, okay? Don't have women take over your role. You're supposed to do your role better. Because if you don't, then they will start trying to take over your role and everything will go to hell, which is what's happened. So, you know, men are weary of the world and they started kind of slacking off and look what happened. So she tried to come to tell men to pick it up. You know, they were slacking. So she went to so many male spiritual leaders in India constantly and tried to inspire them to say, you know what, stick with it, keep working at it, you know, you've got to set the example, you've got to be strong, you've got to be the leaders of this, and don't ask women to come in and do the job for you. They're burdened with their job, you know, and they have to do a better job also, so you both have to work together to get it done. She didn't try to overturn the structure at all, not at all, just the opposite. She was the opposite of a feminist. The total opposite of a feminist. And she's tried to empower me. Most definitely tried to empower me to be a leadership in spiritual sharing. And I'm the way I am now is largely because of all the empowerment she's given me. Because she understands how it works and how the children are so important. The young children, start them with good habits. You have to start them with good habits. When you're young and impressionable and flexible and all this, you have to get a good start in life to really be successful in the spiritual path. It really helps if you have a really good, strong backbone start. And this stuff becomes part of you at a young, young age. It's so important. If you have a really bad upbringing, it's difficult. It's difficult. It's not, you can still do it, but it's difficult. Very difficult. She knows that. I mean, you turn the youth over to the government to raise, and you've lost it. You've lost it, which is what's happened. I mean, the women will say, you know, bring home a book that some man has written, or go to a lecture and bring back something from it and say, okay, kids, you know, we're gonna pay attention to this before dinner. Ah, the kids complain, ah, mom, I'm hungry. No, we're going to spend 5 minutes and we're going to read something from this book here. And or hey, if you want dessert, you're going to have to say this prayer 10 times. And every single meal she'll do that. every single meal. The kids say, Mom, Mom, give me the food. I'm hungry. She says, okay, I got the food here, but you're going to say this prayer 10 times. That's what mothers should be doing. That's what women should be doing. And you're going to learn these prayers by heart. And now we're going to, look at these pictures of saints. And you're going to tell me what you think, what your impressions are about them. And I'm telling you, these are very important. These are like members of our family. These are like our relatives, our spiritual relatives. This saint and this saint and this saint. And you're going to offer, merit of your day to these saints. And you're going to do that as a habit. So all these little children can pick up all these habits easily. They're very flexible, very adaptable. They absorb all these habits. How many houses in California is that happening in? How about zero? How about zero? Right? How many houses, households? It's crazy what's going on. We just don't understand how we fumbled the ball away. And the mother will say, okay, you're going to Sunday school today. And, we want to go play. He says, well, you'll play later. Dad, we don't want to go. He says, well, do what your mom says. And so you've got to do what the mom says. And then she takes them to Sunday school and she makes them do this and she makes them do that and she makes them do that. Right? And then before you know it, the kids later on in life, they're so calm and clear and they understand, like, the purpose of life. They start getting glimpses of the peace of God, and they become very, very virtuous in life like that. And we've lost that. We've lost it. The Mormons still try to do it. It's more traditional, right? Sometimes you meet Mormon youngsters, and they're so gracious and polite and well behaved, and just the whole vibe you get from them is different, very different, because they've lived a strict upbringing. They have to do this, they have to do this. They know they have to go on, men have to go on this mission. Every male has to go on this mission for like a couple years of going around trying to spread the word. So they're trained for all this. The strict upbringing, and it shows. It shows. When you talk to them, they actually look you in the eye and listen to what you say. And if you tell them to do something, they say, yes, sir, yes, ma'am. And there's not all this complaining or any of this stuff like this. They're eager to, they know that you have their best interest at heart. It's kind of like that. That's a religious, household. So children are like that. But in this modern, secular, humanistic, materialistic world, all the kids now are on their tablets, playing, violent games on their tablets. This is the end of civilization. This is the end of civilization. What you get is just a snake pit. It's not civilization. We don't really have civilization anymore, actually. I don't view it as we have civilization here anymore in this world. I really don't view it that way. I don't see it. It's not present. It's really not present anymore. So if you don't have civilization, do you really have a world? Is the world that important if you don't have civilization? Not really, right? The world is supposed to host civilization. And then we'd love the world because it hosted civilization. But if there's no civilization, it's just all crass. It's just all crassness. So the peace of God shows you the world in this beautiful peace has descended upon everything. The hush, this soft hush, this soft, gentle hush of silent peace is upon everything. And you say, wow, what a beautiful, beautiful scene it is. What a beautiful scene it is. Well, it's raining like they said it would. They said it would come in at 9 o'clock, and it certainly did come in at 9 o'clock. And it is raining. It's supposed to be pretty heavy up in Northern California, more up north, Pacific Northwest, Northern California. We're supposed to get like a half an inch, which is really quite a bit. But up north, they're expecting, San Francisco, like an inch, and then north of that, maybe 1 to 3 inches. I mean, this is a substantial rainstorm again. And like Mammoth Mountain is expecting like 1 to 2 feet of snow, 1 to 2 feet of snow. So this is not just some showers, apparently. This is a very strong jet stream pushing this stuff down from up north, and it's going to lay a lot more water on the state, which we're waterlogged as it is, quite waterlogged. Mammoth has how many? Like 512 inches of snow right now, and they're going to get 2 more feet. 500 to 500, almost 530 inches after this is over with. 530 inches. I don't even know how many feet that is, to tell you the truth. Probably like 40, 45 or something, or 45 feet. It's right. I don't know. I can't even divide 12 into, well, 500. 12 into 500, it would be 40. It's 48, 20, so 2, so 42 feet about. Close to 42 feet after the storm. Yeah, 40. So 42 feet. 42 feet of snow. 42 feet of snow. I mean, that's crazy. I mean, that's like up at the top of trees, pine trees. I mean, probably just like the tops of pine trees is all you can see up there. Pine trees are, you can go up 50 to 70 feet or so. I mean, some of them higher, but you're probably just seeing the tops sticking out of the snow. The roads, I don't know what the roads are like up there. Good Lord. That's a lot of water up in the mountains, isn't it? The rivers are going to be just amazing this year, coming down out of the Sierras as that snow melts. Man, the Kern River. You talk about take a drive up the Kern River from the Central Valley to the Eastern Sierra. You can go all the way up the Kern River. I've done that, and that's quite a trip. I mean, that river is when it's just pumping. It's wild. It's powerful, and massive boulders and trees, and it's quite impressive. So any of these trips in California right now are going to be extremely impressive. If you want to see California, come on and drive through the state, this summer or this late spring or something, and it's going to be amazing. The wildflowers are going to be amazing throughout the whole state. I was driving on this freeway yesterday, and when the peace of God was upon me, and it was so beautiful. Flowers everywhere, beautiful yellow flowers, greenery, just lush greenery everywhere. And it was just like, wow. Not only did I have the peace of God, I had this beautiful, beautiful scenery of California. And it's just like, my gosh, like storybook or something. So the state is going to be really something to behold. Yosemite with all the waterfalls. Oh gosh. You kidding? It's just, I don't know what that's going to be like. Yeah, the whole Sierras, they just look out. Here we come. The Golden State is ready to put on a show. But the best way to see it is in the peace of God. And in the peace of God, everything is a show. Everything in this world is a show. It's all gentle glory. It's all gentle glory. Everything is gentle glory. Without fixating on anything special, because it's 360 degree gentle glory. How are we doing here? Oh my gosh, we're like at 2 hours again. Well, I know this is a lot of video to go through, but maybe you're driving. We got a suggestion that to rip MP3s from these videos. Rip MP3s from the videos. There are programs that'll do that. And then just put that on your MP3 player and listen to it while you're driving. I know there must be some way to do that. Well, you can put it on a flash drive and put it in some vehicles will play music off a flash drive, right? You could do it. Could select the flash drive as audio source and play music, and so you can listen to this while you're driving. And if you're like, you know, a lot of people drive a couple hours a day, so you can get through it just by driving. It's like a wonderful dharmic thing to do. This I'm told people to do this. For years I've said do this, and finally somebody's doing it. You know, that's great. That's absolutely great. That's very dharmic. Because what else you're going to do as you're driving? Listen to commercials on the radio? I don't listen to the radio anymore. I refuse to turn on the radio. Someone said, hey, Giants are playing spring training game. Turn it on. I said, no. I said, too many commercials. I don't want to listen to commercials. I haven't listened to the radio for maybe 3 years now. It might be going on almost 3 years. I don't know. It's been quite some time. Forget it. You know, we have to be dharmic now. We have to be really dharmic. And we just have to hear the truth. Even if we realize, we can't really spread it that much. That's true. Like I said, I don't think we're going to get a change in the women of the world. But at least you're aware of the problem, okay? At least you're aware there's an incredibly severe problem here. And that opens up doors. It opens up doors. It really opens doors. And you may realize, say, you know, the peace of God is only, I've got to go for it, because that's the only way I'm going to have peace of mind at all in this world, because it's going to get a lot worse. And it's not going to get better, actually. It is not going to get better here. It can't. It cannot. It literally cannot, the way it's going right now. I mean, good Lord. I mean, anybody opens their mouth and says something common sense, you know, they're burned at the stake. If they got access to the media, they're burned at the stake. These radicals will you know, it's a modern day Inquisition is what's going on, actually. It really is a modern day Inquisition. It's funny, all those that revile the Inquisition, the Middle Age Inquisition, they're the ones now conducting this modern day Inquisition, trying to distract attention off themselves. It's funny, I cleaned up everything today. Spent a lot of work, and now here comes the wind and the rain again. But I just wanted to feel better about how things looked, and so I did it. But I know it's going to get messed up again. I was hoping the wind wouldn't be strong, but it is strong. It's quite strong, actually. So it's going to be all really messy again. I don't know. At least I had one day where it wasn't so messy, because I haven't been able to do it all winter. It's been raining so strong. And I got to swing that golf club, my new driver, with the speed swing I have. Super high hands on the backswing. I evolved the swing today. By swinging the club, I realized, hey, let me see if I can swing it harder. I actually go up on my tiptoes on the backswing. I get up on my tiptoes, and I reach my hands up into the sky as far as I can reach them up into the sky. And then I just allow the arms to just whip through as fast as possible and lead the body. And then on the follow through, I go up on my tiptoes again. I go up on my tiptoes and then really try to collapse the whole body down as fast as possible with the arms leading it through. And that really puts maximum speed on the club head. It really does. Now, you know, you're going to have to be pretty, you know, locked in and to hit the ball in the sweet spot with that kind of swing, but it's doable. I noticed that Bubba Watson, who hits the ball about farther than anyone, he pulls it down from the top. He gets his hands real high, he pulls it down from the top real fast, and he bends his knees like he really like pulling it down, and then he goes up real high on his follow through too. I noticed that dip in his knees. I said, oh my gosh, most don't do that. And I got this tip. I said, yeah, You should pull it down from as high as possible, and so that you dip the knees as you're going down, and that gives an extra kind of lightning to the club, extra lightning. And it might, you know, I might be gaining miles an hour by doing that, maybe 5 to 8 miles an hour. But that's the difference between swinging 108, 105, and 112. And that's a big difference. It's a big difference, actually. And swinging 112, you can hit it 300 yards if launch and spin is right. Whereas you hit 105, you're going to go, one maybe 280 or something. It's just not going to get out there as far. So you get up, you add 8 miles an hour to your swing by doing this. It's a big difference. So it's like I'm all in. My swing's all in. My swing is all in swing right now. It's an all in swing, and I don't want to go to my home golf course, because you can't really swing that way there, because if you're not really accurate, you lose your golf ball every time. So I want to go to a different golf course where it's more open, and I can just absolutely go all in with my swing and hit as far as possible. And if it's offline a little bit, I'm not going to lose the golf ball. I might be in the rough or some trees or something, but that's okay. So I want to play on that sort of a golf course, a more open course. And there are not really that many around here like that. A lot of them are mountain courses here. And you got to be very precise, careful off the tee. And that, it's just no fun. I'm tired of that. I want to go all in. Just like this video is all in. I went all in here. Just like my golf swing, it's all in. Just absolutely let it fly from the top. Just pull it down from the top. Like with holding nothing back, But because I have extra stiff shaft, X shaft, the club remains tremendously stable. It feels great. I can swing as hard as I want to swing, and it still feels totally stable. And it feels wonderful. It feels balanced. Feels stable. It's the best feeling club I've ever swung. I haven't hit a golf ball with it yet, but it just feels just fantastic, actually. Just fantastic. The balance and stability of that club. I can just swing as hard as I want to, and it just feels beautiful. So, in this taping, I'm swinging as hard as possible. I'm up on my toes. I'm saying stuff, that maybe not another soul in the world is going to tell you, really. Afraid of the repercussions to them. And yeah, of course I'm afraid of the repercussions, but I do it anyway. And I want the course to be wide open. And now I understand why Jesus doesn't say this. People say, well, Jesus didn't say that. And now I know why. Because he doesn't want to put too much pressure on us. It would crush us. We're feeble enough as it is. He's not going to put that kind of pressure on us. But when I say it, you can say, well, I'll listen to what's said, but I don't know, there's not as much pressure coming from me. There's not much pressure. You see, you can just sort of listen to it and hear it and say, maybe that's true. Or you might feel, yeah, I know that's true, but okay. But, no. But if Jesus says it, you're going to say, you can tell people, Jesus said this, and they're going to say, are you crazy? They'll start attacking you and attacking Jesus and ruin your relationship with Jesus. But if you say, well, Clarity Ross said this, they go, who's Clarity Ross? I don't know who he is. He's an idiot. Who cares? And it won't, cause you severe problems. They say, well, I don't want you listening to it anymore. And you say, oh, well, okay. But if you said Jesus said this, if they say, well, you can't listen to Jesus anymore, then you're crazy. And then that'll really hurt you, really hurt you bad. So Jesus cannot risk that kind of thing. I can, because there's hardly anyone listens to me anyway. And if they want to stop listening, that's not going to hurt their feelings too much. It's not going to cause them problems, right? So there's a huge difference. I can say this stuff that other people, cannot say. It their position requires much more diplomatic, tactful way of going about it. But they may be feeding me this stuff and saying, hey, could you get this out for me? Could you get this out for me? And they know that I'll say it. I just like leadership. Leaders have to be very tactful. And they have people in their cabinets and stuff who go do the dirty work and go say the tough stuff and carry the ball for them. That's how it works. That's how you get into the Sangha. That's how you get to be a Dharma prince, because you're willing to do the dirty work, the tough stuff. That they cannot say this stuff directly, but you can't. I can do this. And so hopefully, I would assume they appreciate it quite a bit. And that's how you get to be in their quote unquote cabinet, working for them, which is great, which is great. I always wanted to do that. I always thought it'd be nice, like work for a president, or work for an administration, be part of an administration, be part of, a team that's really trying to help culture. So I want to be part of a team. That's fantastic. I would love that. Have some role in an administration, a spiritual administrative role in Longchenpa. I work for Longchenpa. So, hopefully, I can, a role develops for me where I can help him out. Because he knows what it's all about. He knows what it's all about. So, all right. It's only 10 o'clock. What am I going to do for the rest of the evening? Eat? No. I don't know. My voice is kind of getting tired. I did 3.5 hours yesterday. My voice is kind of tired this morning, so I better stop, not do too much. I can always listen to Dion. I put the CD on, put on my earphones or earbuds that sound great, and listen carefully. And listen real carefully, really give it attention, and then I hear it so much better. I really hear it, and I say, "Oh my gosh, the background singers are fabulous." I mean, they should be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. That is true. When Dion was put in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, there was kind of complaints from I think the remaining surviving member of the Belmonts. I think there was only one surviving member. But there are people who said, it should be Dion and the Belmonts. The problem is that he was only with the Belmonts for like a year and a half or 2 years. So, I think the Belmonts should be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame on their own, just for their background work. I mean, it's just some of the, among the best I've ever heard. It's that high. It's so creative and so original and so beautifully done. They may be you can say the Jordanaires are really great in Nashville Edition, but as far as backing singers, they may be, you could say they might be the best ever, the Belmonts. I mean, they were just fabulous. Well, of course, the Beach Boys, but that's a different thing because the Belmonts, Beach Boys are the Beach Boys, but the Belmonts are super great, super super great, and the Del Satins also. Man, what a creative sound! Just two guys. I think it was like two, maybe. I think it was two, maybe three. I thought it might have been just two, but it might have been three the other guy, but maybe just two. The sound that they put out, the doo-wop sound, is just fabulous. It's great music, great music. I really think that they were the best at doo-wop. Dion and the Belmonts were the kings of doo-wop. I really believe that. What a sound they got. Put them in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Come on. They deserve it. Actually, if someone put me in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, I would decline. I would decline. I would decline. I don't want to be part of that. Dion doesn't need that, actually. If you get it, you get it, okay? It's like George Jones. I mean, if you're really an aficionado of, if you're really country music, he's the king of country music. There's no doubt about it. And those who know that, they know it very well. And there's no argument at all. It's just nobody can sing like him at all. And Dion is really, really the king of doo-wop. There's nobody that really sang like that. He was so good. So good. Still singing so good. He's just amazing, amazing singer. Just so, the voice, just how he sang, just had this, just moved, it just smooth, it just moved in a smooth, creative, very creative, subtly creative. He just knew how to not oversing, but still put all the soul into his singing, inflections and cadence and everything. Man, did he know how to sing. Natural born singer. Same with George Jones, natural born singer. They just had it. Elvis had it too, Yeah, absolutely. Elvis had it. Man, I miss those singing days. I mean, I love great singing, great music. Great music needs great singers and needs great background singers. The women background singers on Lonely Teenager just do a fabulous job. I love that, the combination of Dion on those singers. It's such a great balance. And, you know, it's just wow. I said, where's that gone? I mean, what a sound that is. That song, Lonely Teenager by Dion. I don't even know who the singers are. I can't find out who they were, but they just did a tremendous job. There again, you have that beautiful dichotomy of male and female there, the balance there, different roles, and yet the song is so great because of it. You know, if it was just Dion singing that song, it wouldn't be nearly as good. You put the female background singers together with Dion, and it works totally. Now, if you get a female singing the lead and male's background, it's not going to work. It's just not going to work. Really, it's not going to work right. This way, you can feel just the complementariness of it, you know, and it's how it's just, wow, it's a knockout song. I never heard it before. I only heard it like a couple months ago for the first time. I couldn't believe it. It's like one of the best songs ever. I never heard it before. And I didn't hear those singers on those other songs used. I don't know who they were, but holy cow. I would put them on a record. Songs I would put them on in a heartbeat. Man, I mean, you can't miss with that kind of background singing. Just the good old days, right? When people had the love of God in them and wanted the peace of God in their lives, and they knew that they were lacking it. They knew that they were lacking it, you know, and they knew that they were sinners. They knew that they were biased against the peace of God, biased against certainty, and they wanted to do something about it, and they wanted to find it. And they knew that they needed complement one another, and they needed help, that culture needed to help them. They needed to help culture, and culture needed to help them find the peace of God. Not through social engineering. They knew it only comes through the grace of God and not through anything that man does, you know. Humanity does nothing that humanity does. It only comes through the grace of God. It's the only way. They knew that back then. Now, I don't know how many even know that anymore. Especially in California, there's a few places, but you know, it's the modern young people. Do they really know that? Do they know it in their hearts? And is that the most important thing in their life? I think their smartphone is the most important thing in their lives. And you know, the content. It's unbelievable how eager the tech companies are to overlook religion and spirituality. That they're just super desirous to overlook it completely. I mean, I don't know how it is now, but I've monitored the various like Yahoo and Google and various, you know, big social media sites, etc., for, you know, what they're what their take on was, and they tried to ignore religion. They tried their best to ignore it. They put all these categories, you know. You see categories, people, you know, sports, weather, news, cinema, fashion, horoscope. No religion. It's not even a category. They don't even have a category for the most important thing in the world. They don't even have a category for it. Most newspapers don't even either have even a category for it anymore. It's unbelievable, isn't it? That those people are teaching our children on smartphones don't even have a category for spiritual religion and spiritual, you know, category. They don't even have a category for it. It doesn't exist. In their world, it's not even important enough to even put a category at all. You know, choose what genre of music or something. No religious music. It's not even a genre. It's not even a genre. But they got everything else there, you know. Thrash metal, whatever you want, vocal rasp, you know, everything. No religious music, though. Right? You know, a few begrudgingly occasionally try to, you know, say, well, they put a little bit, but you can tell that they just are not into it at all. They think it's some sort of myopic, old-fashioned, antiquated, you know, out of fashion ridiculousness, and we need to move on from that stuff. That's their attitude. And they couldn't be more wrong. They couldn't be more mistaken, actually. So why are we letting them train our kids about what's important? We're letting those who couldn't be more mistaken take charge of the education of our children. And women are okay with that, you know? They seem to be. But deep down, they can't be. They can't be, you know? Nobody's really all right with that. Nobody's all right with it. But I don't think anyone knows what to do because we've been bottled up. So don't be surprised if a lot of people decide, you know what? This world, I've had enough of it. And can we make a fresh start? Can we do, you know, what could we do? But this is not what we really want at all. It's not. I know deep down this is how people really feel, deep down. But they feel boxed in. They feel straitjacketed. Really, they do. So I'm just saying what people are really feeling deep within. That's what they're really feeling. But they're like the silent scream. Everybody has a silent scream, you know, on their shoulder. They walk around with a silent scream, but that's all it is. It's a silent scream world right now. But I'm screaming for you. I'm screaming for you here. And so thank you to all the viewers who are, you know, help encourage me to do this. And we can't, you know, become extinct. You know, we have to keep our options open because something is going to happen. Sri Sri Anandamayi is absolutely in the house in a very strong way. And like she always said, you know, what this body does is very unpredictable. That is true. You cannot predict what she's going to do. But she's going to do the right thing at the right moment. That is for sure. Always does. What that is, we don't know. But it's I can feel it. I can feel it. There's no doubt about it. And Jesus is in the house, Longchenpa's in the house, Jamyang Kensi Choki Lodo's in the house, Pabasava's in the house, Manjushri's in the house, Ramana's in the house. Okay, so what are the Dharma Kings going to do? Only they know. It's for them to know and for us to find out. Okay, it's for them to know and for us to find out. So hang in there and we will find out probably quite soon. Very great. That's it for this one.